In the last couple of videos, we spent a lot of time thinking critically about the conversion of glucose to glucose-6-phosphate. In this video, we're going to go through a similar process of thinking about the reaction that converts dihydroxyacetone phosphate into glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate. This is step number 5 in the glycolysis pathway. We'll first think about the mechanism that this reaction proceeds through, and then we'll look at the active site of the enzyme and see how it presents a chemical environment that can facilitate this mechanism. The overall equilibrium that occurs here is the conversion of an aldehyde into a ketone. So glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate is an aldehyde, and dihydroxyacetone phosphate is a ketone. Okay, what we notice here is that the number of atoms have not changed. Okay, so we have exactly the same chemical formula in these two molecules, which means what we've done is an isomerization. So this enzyme that does it is an isomerase. That's an enzyme that catalyzes an isomerization reaction. And specifically, we call this enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. We abbreviate this either TPI or TIM. Okay? In the image I'm showing here, I've highlighted the hydrogens that are moving. You notice on the left side in our aldehyde, we have both hydrogens present surrounding the middle carbon. And on our products in this reaction, I'm showing both hydrogens surrounding our first carbon. Okay, so this is the reaction that needs to happen, right? The way that the enzyme facilitates this is that it presents amino acids at very specific and logical places in the active site to promote this reaction. So in this case, what we see is a general base. So this is an amino acid side chain that can serve as a base oriented towards one hydrogen. And we have a general acid oriented towards another one. So the first step in this reaction is our base is going to reach out. It's going to make a bond with this proton, which causes the electrons in this CH bond to move over, forming a double bond between the first and second carbon, and ultimately causing this double bond to break, ending up with an alcohol. So the product of this reaction is an intermediate where we now have a double bond formed between carbon 1 and 2. We have the desired alcohol present on carbon number 1, but we have not yet formed the carbonyl on carbon number 2. Okay? What we've also done is switch the general acid and general base that's present in the active site. What was originally a base is now protonated, so it's an acid, and what was originally an acid is now deprotonated, so it's a base. In the next step of this reaction, we can really kind of reverse what just happened. But now we're going to use these electrons to deprotonate the alcohol on the second carbon. Okay, so we end up protonating this molecule here. This causes these electrons to move over, creating a double bond, which is our desired carbonyl. These electrons in the double bond now reach out and grab that hydrogen off of our original general base. So when we redraw this, we end up with the desired product. We're confident that this is a complete mechanism because we have regenerated our active site. The original base is now once again a base, and the original acid is now protonated, so it's again an acid. The idea now is that this substrate can dissociate out of the active site and go on to do another reaction. Okay? The really neat thing about this active site is that it's perfectly reversible. So we've shown this reaction starting with the aldehyde and creating the ketone, but we can do this easily in reverse by doing exactly the same thing. But now in this case, we would start off by deprotonating this carbon to make a double bond, and then this would reach out and grab that proton. So that would result in our intermediate, which could then reverse and create our aldehyde. So this is a really interesting enzyme in that it can very rapidly catalyze this reaction in either direction. So we truly do have an equilibrium. So now that we have a basic understanding of the mechanism, let's go ahead and shift our focus to the enzyme that catalyzes this reaction, the triose phosphate isomerase. What we see here is that this is a protein that contains alpha helices on the outside of the protein, and they surround this kind of core of beta sheets. This structural formation is what's known as an alpha-beta barrel or a TIM barrel, okay? In the center of this is our active site. And if we zoom in, what we see is the substrate, in this case, a substrate analog, a molecule that looks like the actual substrate, but has a couple structural differences. This is bound in the active site, and we can see that most of the hydrogen bond interactions are focused around the position of the phosphate. And we have a couple hydrogen bonds that are present on the first carbon. Okay, these interactions orient the molecule so that this really important glutamic acid is able to serve as the general acid and the general base in this reaction. So we're going to go ahead and end our investigation of this triose phosphate isomerase here. What I hope you got out of this video, as well as the previous two, is that we can learn a lot about how enzymes work by looking at their structure and thinking very critically about the role they play and how they do so.